Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us today at our West webinar for August 25th, 2021. Wanted to welcome everyone for joining us to our presentation today. Well, we'll be doing something a little special, but hopefully it becomes more of the norm. We're going to be having one of our fellow colleagues out in Italy do a presentation on microfluidic assisted synthesis of multifunctional iodinated contrast agent polymeric nanoplatforms. Our guest today is Dr. Enrica Chiesa from the University of Pavia, where she is getting her postdoc there with the engineering department this time around. As always, of course, prior to starting our webinar, wanted to first introduce our team here with the West region, west of the Mississippi, essentially. Starting with our Southwest team, Kim Killian, based out of San Diego, covering the Southwest region. We have Viet Nguyen, our field application scientist, based out of the greater Los Angeles area, but also covering the Southwest. Out of the Northwest, covering and based out of San Francisco Bay Area, covering all the way north up to Vancouver, and east of that is Ian Villamagna. And of course, I'm Angel Galarza, the Regional Sales Director for the West and this team that you have of yours. As always, of course, if you do miss something from this particular webinar or any webinar that we have here for the West, please feel free to find it on our YouTube page under West Webinar, and that is an acronym, W.E.S.T, hour. We also have our journal clubs. Without further ado, I'd like to pass it over and hand it over to Dr. Enrica Chiesa to present her seminar today. Enrica.
Good morning to everyone, and thanks to the organizers to give me the opportunity to share our recent work on the microfluidic production of a multifunctional polymeric nanoplatform for the delivery of iodinated contrast agent and N-acetylcysteine as an antioxidant preventive drug to counteract the contrast-induced nephropathy. Contrast-induced nephropathy is one of the most dreaded contrast media side effects that compromise the renal vessels and the tubules' functionality. Its physiopathology is still poorly understood. Current knowledge shows that contrast media affect the renal vessel and tubules damaged by renal ischemia and by the production of reactive oxygen species, consequently assisting oxidative stress, vessels narrowing, and apoptosis of renal cells. The combination of these factors decrease the renal blood flow and the tubular glomerular filtration rate. To date, an effective approach is and treatment are lacking, and this pathology is still associated with high healthcare costs and long hospitalization. Contrast-induced nephropathy indices ranges from 2 to 30%, depending on the harshness of the pre-existing renal failure and the long-term outcome of the patients. Several preventive approaches have been adopted, such as hydration, administration of antioxidants such as N-acetylcysteine, the administration of statins, and hemofiltration. However, the beneficial effect of these strategies are not supported by proper powered clinical results, and further strategies need to be investigated. Nanoparticles represent a promising strategies for non-invasive diagnosis thanks to the ability to deliver the contrast media during diagnosis imaging, thus avoiding the main drawback associated with these compounds, such as short blood half-life, non-specific biodistribution, fast clearance, and renal toxicity. By packing a variety of active pharmaceutical ingredients into particulate system, drug innovators aim to protect the payload and prolong its circulation time, alter and improve the biodistribution, and control the spatio-temporal release of their drug. Here, a special focus is given on polymeric nanoparticles that show great stability and resistant against various stimuli and overall resistant against the fast elimination of mononuclear phagocytic system. Moreover, the main advantages of using polymeric nanoparticle is the potential for simultaneously encapsulating both contrast agent and drug to obtain a multifunctional nanoplatform. Accordingly, several ionidine nanoparticles have been developed. However, there are some issues that currently limit their application in vivo, such as the low encapsulation efficiency and the burst release of the drug. The aim of this work is to exploit the microfluidic technology to co-encapsulate UXOL, a ionidated contrast agent, and an acetyl cysteine into PLGA and pegylated PLGA nanoparticle to exploit UXOL diagnostic property and an acetyl cysteine preventive antioxidant activity. UXOL is a water-soluble non-ionic contrast agent. It is routinely used in diagnostic field and eliminated by glomerular filtration into 2 hours. An acetyl cysteine has drawn great attention thanks to its antioxidant and anti-inflammatory properties and thanks to its ability to stimulate the production of vasodilatatory mediator. All these factors, the idea is that an acetyl cysteine may prevent the contrast media induced oxidative stress and protect the kidney functionality. The rationale of this work is threefold: producing nanoparticle with suitable size and size distribution to avoid the renal clearance and the detection of reticuloendothelial system. Second, reducing the UXOL linkage to prevent both systemic and nephrotoxicity and to prolong its blood circulation. And finally, sustaining the acetyl cysteine release to exploit its antioxidant properties. Why using a microfluidic device? Because microfluidic can overcome the key challenges in nanomedicine development, since it is characterized by outstanding reproducibility. A computer control removes the batch-to-batch and the user variability. It has an intuitive flow work. We are able to control the assembly of the nanoparticle. We are able to tune the particle size thanks to the precise control over the free flow rate. It is a versatile technique. We are able to formulate a small molecule, peptide, and nucleic acid into several types of nanoparticle. Moreover, it is speedy and efficient, enabling the rapid nanoparticle screening to reach the nanoparticle prototype. Finally, it is scalable by the parallelization of the microfluidic channel. Within the range of the microfluidic device available on the market, a strange herringbone micromixer with the automatic system nanoassembler was used. A strange herringbone micromixer is a Y-shaped device with a characteristic pattern of grooves inside the channel. This pattern of groove induces a chaotic adventure mixing profile, causing the repeated and rapid fall of the two solution, increasing the surface area at the interface and reducing the diffusional distance, and thus increasing the mixing rate. This work was born from our experience in these fields, starting from 2017 with the setup of microfluidics assisted nanoprecipitation method for the synthesis of PLGA nanoparticle intended for the loading of N-acetylcysteine. And in this case, N-acetylcysteine is chosen as a worst case for its issues to be encapsulated into hydrophobic polymeric nanoparticle. Then in 2019, we started a collaboration with the team of Professor Lamproof of the Queen University of Belfast for the production of liposomes containing UXOL. And finally, we decided to combine these two experiences to produce a polymeric nanoplatform for the co-delivery of the contrast agent and N-acetylcysteine to prevent the renal failure after the contrast agent administration. Microfluidic technology is already validated to be a consolidated method for the synthesis of PLGA and pegylated PLGA nanoparticle. In our previous work, we described the setup of the method by a systematic approach to establish the link between the critical parameter of the process and the critical quality attributes of the formulation. And if you are interested, all the information are reported in this paper. Briefly, for the setup of the method, design of experiment with the full factorial design was used to investigate the effect of selected inputs such as total flow rate, flow aeration, PLGA concentration, and N-acetylcysteine PLGA weight ratio on the selected outcome, in this case, particle size. For each input, a minimum and maximum level were selected, and all the possible combinations were tested. Results are reported in this table, and they were analyzed by a software and graphically represented by Pareto chart and response surface plot. Pareto chart shows the impact of each factor or two-factor interaction on the response. It contains a bar for each factor, sorted from the most significant to the least significant, and the length of the bar is proportional to the standardized effect. As you can see here, flow ratio is the factor having the most significant effect on the particle size. In literature, it's reported that flow ratio influences the diffusional length for solvent and non-solvent moieties, and in turn, the solvent jump, which drives the nanoprecipitation process. Moreover, flow ratio is correlated to the mixing time, that is a key parameter for the production of nanoparticle, in order to reach a theoretical equilibrium between the mixing time and the polymer aggregation time. Design of experiment was also used to investigate the effect of total flow rate, flow aeration, and N-acetylcysteine PLGA weight ratio on the N-acetyl cysteine encapsulation efficiency. In this case, the factors having most significant effect on the N-acetyl cysteine encapsulation efficiency are flow-rate ratio, the drug polymer weight ratio, and their interaction. The drug encapsulation efficiency can be affected by several factors, including the drug solubility, the solvent use, the drug polymer interaction, and overall the manufacturing process. What we want to underline here is that microfluidic technology leads to obtain the best results in terms of N-acetyl cysteine encapsulation efficiency compared to the optimized bulk mixing method. Moreover, in drug delivery field, the encapsulation of a small hydrophilic drug is still tricky, and new approaches need to be investigated to reduce the drug leaching in the outer aqueous phase. Microfluidic method was then optimized to load UXOL and N-acetyl cysteine. The impact of the polymer's characteristic were studied in terms of lactide glycolide molar ratio, molecular weight, and surface modification with PEG chains. PLGA and pegylated PLGA were dissolved at the concentration of 10 mg per milliliter in acetonitrile or DMSO. Tris buffer was used as non-solvent at the organic solvent to aqueous buffer ratio of 1:4. The impact of the production speed was also evaluated by testing two different total flow rate, 6 and 13 ml per minute. Meanwhile, the drug polymer weight ratio was kept constant at 1:10 based on previous results. A set of preliminary data was performed, and by using acetonitrile, nanoparticle size was always below 200 nanometer, with not significant differences observed across the production speed, except for the first one, PLGA, with a molecular weight of 25 kilodalton, for which particle size decrease from 150 to 19 nanometer along with increasing the production speed from 6 to 13 ml per minute. Other PLGA nanoparticle had particle size of 66 nanometer. Meanwhile, pegylated nanoparticle shows the smallest nanoparticle size with mean diameter of around 50 nanometer. All PLGA and pegylated PLGA nanoparticle are homogeneous in size, moreover, pegylated nanoparticle shows the narrowest size distribution. Using DMSO gave rise to an important nanoparticle enlargement. Moreover, changing the organic solvent from acetonitrile to DMSO, the nanoparticles are more heterogeneous in size, show PDI value between 0.2 and 0.6. So based on this these results, acetonitrile was selected as organic solvent, and the microfluidic operating parameter used for further experiment are 1:4 as flow rate ratio and 13 ml per minute as total flow rate. Aiming to encapsulate UXOL and N-acetyl cysteine, ethanol was added to the polymer solution at the concentration of 10%. Ethanol was used as a suitable solvent for both drug, and as a well-known co-solvent called a driving solvent in nanoprecipitation process. Thanks to its ability to actively promote the synthesis of well-formed PLGA nanoparticle. The next step is to evaluate the effect of the encapsulation of the different payload into the nanoplatform. The N-acetyl cysteine loading effect on nanoparticle is reported in Table 5, and as you can see here, the N-acetyl cysteine loading cause an important enlargement of nanoparticle size for a PLGA polymer. Instead, pegylated PLGA nanoparticle did not undergo any changes in size, showing particle size of 61 and 87 nanometer. However, the N-acetyl cysteine encapsulation trigger an increase of size distribution of pegylated PLGA nanoparticle. However, the PDI value was always below 0.2. For both polymer PLGA and pegylated PLGA, the highest encapsulation efficiency was reached using the highest molecular weight. In particular, for PLGA polymers, PLGA with 66 kilodalton molecular weight shows encapsulation efficiency of 61%. Meanwhile, for pegylated PLGA, polymer with the molecular weight of 19 kilodalton show an encapsulation efficiency of the 41%. Unlike N-acetyl cysteine loaded nanoparticle, UXOL did not affect the particle size if compared to the placebo counterpart, and the particle size ranges from 120 nanometer to 50 nanometer. The encapsulation efficiency was between 15 and 40%. Based on these results and considering the advantages of using a pegylated polymer to prolong the nanoparticle circulation time, pegylated PLGA with a molecular weight of 90 kilodalton was used for the co-encapsulation test. Morphological examination of this sample reveal particle sites with a spherical shape. This image were elaborated by a software, and the dimension is consistent with those of DLS analysis. UXOL and N-acetyl cysteine loaded nanoparticle disclose a particle size of around 67 nanometer. They are uniform in size, and the co-encapsulation significantly affect the encapsulation of both payload. In particular, N-acetyl cysteine encapsulation efficiency was reduced from 40% to 20%. Meanwhile, UXOL encapsulation efficiency was increased from 24% to 38%. Then drug release study was performed. On the left, you can find the N-acetyl cysteine release profile from N-acetyl cysteine loaded nanoparticle dashed line and N-acetyl cysteine UXOL loaded nanoparticle full line. As you can see here, the co-encapsulation significantly affect the initial release of the drug. At 2 hours of incubation, the N-acetyl cysteine release is 28% when encapsulated alone and 50% when encapsulated with UXOL. On the right, the UXOL release profile, and in this case, the co-encapsulation reduced the UXOL release over the time at 168 hours. The UXOL release is 33% when encapsulated alone, and around 10% when encapsulated with an acetylcysteine. This test proved the usefulness of polymeric nanoparticle to control the release of both drugs, in particular to reach the UXOL retention into the polymeric matrix and the N-acetylcysteine release up to 24 hours. Then UXOL and N-acetylcysteine loaded nanoparticle were analyzed by DSC. Nanoparticle were compared to the raw material. And as you can see here, for the polymer at the second heating, the thermogram shows a glass transition at around 40 degrees, followed by sample decomposition around over 200 Celsius degrees. For UXOL, we did not show any peak, so we can claim that is not crystalline. Instead, N-acetylcysteine shows an endothermic peak at 111 Celsius degrees due to the melting. And finally, nanoparticle revealed the polymer glass transition at 38 degrees and the N-acetylcysteine melting point at 110 Celsius degrees, corresponding to 0.5% of N-acetylcysteine in the sample. The UXOL entrapment into the nanoparticle was also evaluated by FTR analysis. Nanoparticle FTR spectrum was compared to those of the raw material, and the spectrum of nanoparticle is very similar to that of the pure polymer. However, characteristic signal for UXOL corresponding to the oxidized stretching and carbonyl stretching vibration are evident. Finally, to assess the cytocompatibility of the nanoparticle formulation, renal cells were tested with the increasing concentration of nanoparticle. Equal dose of the free drug was used as control. And as you can see here, the N-acetylcysteine UXOL loaded nanoparticle are less toxic than the free drug and the UXOL loaded nanoparticle. More in detail, the EC50 value of free UXOL is fold more toxic than the EC50 value of UXOL loaded nanoparticle. As expected, N-acetylcysteine showed the lowest toxic profile, either in nanoparticle or in solution, with the encapsulation efficiency always higher than the 60%. And finally, the UXOL and N-acetylcysteine loaded nanoparticles show an EC50 of around 450 microgram per milliliter, higher than the free UXOL and the UXOL loaded nanoparticle. So the co-encapsulation of the contrast agent and N-acetylcysteine trigger an important reduction of the cytotoxicity when tested on renal cells. The results obtained until now are very encouraging. Microfluidic technology is a powerful tool for the formulation of multifunctional nanoplatform with diagnostic and preventive purposes. The suitability of microfluidic technology for the encapsulation of small hydrophilic drug is confirmed, leading to obtain best results in terms of encapsulation efficiency for all the polymer used, and to screen the nanoparticle formulation to reach the nanoparticle prototype. The selected sample show required size and size distribution, and overall a proper release of the drug, the UXOL retention into the polymeric matrix, and the sustained N-acetylcysteine release up to 24 hours. Finally, the co-encapsulation of N-acetylcysteine and the UXOL into polymeric nanoparticle reduced the cytotoxicity of the contrast agent when tested on kidney cells. Finally, I want to thank all my group of the Department of Drug Science, Professor Ida Genta, my supervisor, the head of the group, Professor Bice Conti, Antonietta Greco, who is the PhD student working with me in this project, and Professor Dimitros Lampru of the Queen University of Belfast, and thank you for your attention.
Yes, thank you, Enrique. I appreciate the time and wanted to thank you once again for joining us today here in the West Hour for presenting your data and information. Along with that, I wanted to remind everyone again that we have all of these presentations from our guests on our Precision Nanosystems YouTube channel. You just type in Precision Nanosystems into YouTube and you'll be able to see a lot of these different webinars, not only from the West webinars that you saw Enrique present today, but also different webinars that we've had from the past from different regions. As I mentioned, our European colleagues have a similar program called the Tea Time webinar. You can see all that stuff as well. Another reminder, of course, is that we have this West webinar the last Wednesday of every month. Yes, today is the last Wednesday of August. We start a new month in a couple of days. So we'll have another one of these in September and throughout the year. Please look out for the invites on that. Along with that, of course, we have our journal clubs, which are the second Friday of every month. So journal club to discuss journals in a more free form conversation, second Friday of every month, and our West webinar, the last Wednesday of every month. We'll have lunch and learn sporadically on occasion for the West. And of course, there's always different stuff coming out from Precision Nanosystems, so look out for that. And make sure to join us whenever you can. Thank you, everyone, for your time. Have a great rest of the week, and we look forward to seeing you next time. Thank you, Enrique, again. Really appreciate it. Take care.